Yeah, good evening all doctors, and thank you very much for having spared your valuable time to be a part of this webinar. I, Vidhan Patnaik, DGA Marketing from Zuventus Marketing Team, welcome you all to today's webinar, that is Post-COVID Osteonecrosis, a recent topic of interest which has not been discussed much before. This is a scientific initiative of Zuventus Odinia, which is the pain management wing of Zuventus Healthcare Limited. Zuventus Odinia has been a part of Zuventus Healthcare for the last 11 years with a motto to alleviate pain and suffering in people's lives. With this motto in mind, we have strived to bring in some good molecules and technology to the Indian market, with few being first time in India also. Few brands of ours which are catering to the sufferings of people are Myotop, Tendoform, Cetolac, transdermal patches like Ketoplast, Dycloplast, Bupriplast, to name a few. We have always believed in associating ourselves with science in this era of evidence-based medicines. Hence, we could not have missed a chance to be associated with this topic, which is being observed as a post-COVID complication. Lastly, this motto of ours, that is to alleviate pain and suffering in people's lives, will not take its shape without the support of medical fraternity. So we look forward for a long-term association with you and would not hesitate to be a partner in such scientific initiatives. Now, without taking much time, I would like to introduce the speaker of today's CME, who is known to all of us. He is Dr. Shushrut Babulkar. He is the founder, member, International OTA, President, Trauma Society of India, Vice President, NAILS, Task Force, Lower Limb of AO Trauma Regional, Chief Center for Joint Reconstruction Surgery, Shushrut Institute of Medical Sciences. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much for your kind words, Mr. Babul. And thank you, Zuventus, to share my thoughts on this. This is for the first time, actually, we are discussing osteonecrosis as a post-COVID, post-steroid intake complication in India, in fact, in the world. We have thought about it. We have discussed this in non-scientific platforms. Some publications have recently come up as prediction of this as a complication, but let's look at this as what we find. So in this struggle for saving one's hip, we decided to look at osteonecrosis or avascular necrosis, as it is commonly known as, or bone death in terms of non-medical terminology. Let's look at this as a post-COVID scenario complication that we are seeing. In last few weeks, we have realized that in an attempt to save lives of patients, in the whole medical treatment, which was absolutely essential to bring the patient out of crisis in those days, steroid being one of them, musculoskeletal complications are on tremendous rise. Some of the patients are presenting as just pain. Some have exaggerated joint pains. Some have come with exacerbation of their pre-existing joint pains. Some have manifested as osteoporosis or bone weakness, leading to fragility fractures. and a significant number has also been seen as avascular necrosis or osteonecrosis. We looked at some of these patients who came to us with hip pain, with low back pain, with radiation to hip pain, with anterior thigh pain or knee pain getting radiated to the hip pain, and we discovered that clinically as well as MRI once done, these patients have avascular necrosis of bone. So what happens in avascular necrosis? Is it a new entity or is it a known entity? Let's look at this, and that's why this topic is being churned scientifically. We will look at in next few minutes whether avascular necrosis has been known to us, has been known to orthopedic world in India, in the world. Let's see the scientific history of this and scientifically what we as orthopedic surgeons have been dealing with this. There are some people in audience who are physicians. There are some people in audience today who are non-medicos. So I will use some terminologies which are non-scientific but easy to understand in common language. So bear with me. Osteonecrosis of the hip is the scientific term. What is it? It is a multifactorial heterogeneous group of disorders that leads to a common pathology of mechanical failure of femoral head. Now, this particular condition is common in the hip joint. Why? Because we walk on the hip joint. Because of this condition, there is a mechanical failure, collapse, destruction, arthritis. That's why it is commonly seen in hip joint, but it is also seen in other joints like shoulder. We see it there as well. But what we want is, as orthopedic surgeons, as good physicians, we must, with our high index of clinical suspicion, clinical acumen, diagnose it early, and with our surgical finesse, strive against its progression. We should try to stop it as early as it can be stopped. And there are various stages it travels through, and I will explain you how it travels. So is it a new entity? Is it something new that the scientific world has discovered? No, it's not new. We have been knowing about this. Just that post-COVID, it is been seen as a complication of the medical treatment. Of course, it was absolutely essential to give steroids that point in time to that particular patient, because otherwise the patient could not have been saved. We have given in the past steroids for skin diseases. We have given steroids in the past for asthma, for various critical conditions, because steroid is a known life-saving medicine. But even the smallest dose of steroid, which is unknown, what's the smallest dose which can cause this is unknown scientifically. But even the smallest dose of steroid can lead to this known complication of bone death or osteonecrosis. So as I said, it's been known. So that's a Bible of avascular necrosis published by American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons. And I have written a chapter in it on avascular necrosis in sickle cell. And we have actually contributed a lot academically. We have written books on osteonecrosis. We have published data from Nagpur, India, in various peer-reviewed journals in last 30, 40 years. So it's been known, the condition has been known to us scientifically, and we have dealt with it. So these are a couple of books that we have written on the subject. So it's not new. But where are we today? How should it be dealt with scientifically? Can we diagnose it early so that we can stop its progression? Can we treat this condition? How can we treat its condition? We'll see. So early diagnosis, various treatment options, and its outcome, because it affects younger patients. It affects young, active, young individuals who are working. So that's the importance of this. And because it affects hip predominantly, it is important to save the hip joint. Because if you are not able to save the hip joint in a younger patient, he gets bedridden, she gets bedridden, and the earning completely stops. It's a very painful condition. So let's look at what we have been doing. So this is a 21-year-old female with, you see, even on the X-ray, it's not seen rounded. See, this is the rounded hip on one side. See how it is collapsed and collapsing. That is called as a crescent sign in scientific language, in orthopedic language, in radiological language. So it is collapsing. It's called as a crescent sign, and we know about it. Patient, that individual with complaint of pain, most commonly it's in the hip joint, almost 75% to 80%. But there are incidences when the patient or the individual can present with a low back pain, with buttock pain, with knee pain, because the pain from the hip joint gets radiated to these areas. So we as medical diagnosing persons, we as medical personnel should not neglect even the low back pain. This is a very classic test, which is called as a sectoral deviation test, which tells us about restriction of hip movements, and the hip goes in a particular direction. That's why it is called as sectoral deviation test. And these are all big people today. And Sugioka is a Japanese person who has designed a surgery to save the femoral head. And that's me, many, many years back, young me. So diagnosis is very, very important. We can use X-ray. We can use scintigraphy, which means isotope bone scan. FBI means functional bone investigation, like measurement of bone inside, the pressure measurements. We can do MRI, we can do CT scan, and we can do biopsy, pathology. That's how we can diagnose it. Now, as I suggested, it travels from one stage to another and progresses from stage 0 to stage 4. There are various ways it has been classified in the past. The first classification, which came in 1967 by these French radiologists, was from early to transition to late. So that's of historical importance. Then this classification came from stage 1 to stage 6. But the most important classification, which is followed worldwide, is this ARCO classification, which is Association Research Circulation Osseous Classification, which divides osteonecrosis of the hip joint from stage 0 to stage 4. Stage 0 is basically normal. Stage 1 is X-ray, shows some changes, but you do MRI and you'll pick it up. Stage 2, X-ray will start showing some changes. Stage 3 is that collapse occurring, crescent sign has appeared, early collapse is there. And stage 4 is advanced collapse, arthritic changes, and then probably only replacement remains the surgery of choice, and nothing more than that is possible. So X-ray examination earlier done is of limited value, because early, either you can suspect it clinically, suspect is based on what patients or what that individual will tell you. Like patient had COVID, patient has received steroids for a prolonged duration. Then you can diagnose that, okay, we are suspecting this, get an MRI done early. Not all patients who had COVID, not all patients who had steroid should go for MRI, should go for X-ray. So don't be afraid. Consult your orthopedic surgeon. Let orthopedic surgeon decide whether you need any investigation or not. Don't rush to investigate yourself. Don't be afraid about it. But telling your orthopedic surgeon and orthopedic surgeon diagnosing it is important. Bone scan can diagnose it. It has a high sensitivity, but it's an invasive method. We have to inject some dye inside the body, and that's how it will look. It will light that bulb in the hip joint. It will show some light there on the isotope bone scan. But the most important is MRI, very sensitive, very accurate, and it will show changes which even the X-rays are yet to show. So stage one, and it will show, it will pick up that changes of osteonecrosis or bone death, like band, alternate band like images in T1 as well as T2 weighted images. That's technical word, but MRI is sensitive and should be considered to diagnose osteonecrosis. It's a double line sign which is seen on T1 and T2. MRI is highly specific, highly sensitive, and it has got a high spatial resolution value. Let's look at management. Once an individual is diagnosed, is it treatable? That's the condition, that's the question which lot of physician colleagues, which lot of patient individuals ask us. Sir, tell me whether this condition is treatable. The answer is yes, it's treatable, but there are various ways to manage it. And the management, the surgical pathway, will depend on age of the patient, whether it is only in the one hip or two hips or multiple joints, whether it is associated with associated disease, how long the COVID has been there, how long since the active affection of COVID, and whether there are any other associated diseases like osteoporosis, like diabetes, cardiovascular disease, etc. What is the demand of that patient and need of the hip? Whether the patient is a farmer, manual laborer, executive, sitting job, the treatment will depend on that also. And of course, it will depend on what stage of osteonecrosis one is coming to us. If the patient is coming early, if the patient has been diagnosed early, we can completely revert the process to normal. So stage one, stage two, 60 to 70% good chances that it will become normal after some surgical procedure, and we'll see what surgical procedures they are. Stage three, 40 to 45% chances that it will come back to normal by doing some surgical procedure, head preservation surgery, preserving patient's own head and not replacing it. But of course, if the patient is diagnosed late, if the patient reports late, if the patient comes to doctor late, diagnosed late, or if the patient has been unfortunate with a faster progression of disease stage four, then at stage four, hip replacement, various types of hip replacements, uncemented, cemented, but what replacement to be done depends on the bone quality. But then that remains the only choice at stage four, which is the late disease. What are the associated diseases? What can also cause avascular necrosis or osteonecrosis in our part of the world? Nagpur, Vidarbha, and around, sickle cell disease has been known to lead to avascular necrosis. Alcohol abuse, steroids abuse in the post-COVID period, steroids use in the pre-COVID, non-COVID patients. Associated diseases can be liver disease, Gaucher's disease, following renal transplant, and lastly, idiopathic. Cause is not known. It just happens. Idiopathic is also an unknown cause in some patients, amounting to 3 to 5% of the total number of patients. Let's look at how an orthopedic surgeon can preserve one's hip. We can do some procedures which are more biological procedures using some kind of vessels or vascularity of patient's own circulation to preserve patient's own hip joint. That's the best case scenario. So the various options are these. Various treatment options depending on various stages of the disease an individual is presenting to us will be core decompression. We just create a tunnel in the femoral head, take away the pressure of the femoral head or the hip joint, push a fibula or one of the bones or artificial bones inside. Muscle pedicle grafting is taking a portion of muscle with the bone stock and pushing it in the hip joint. Vascularized grafts is taking the vascular network, the best case scenario, taking with the muscle, with the piece of bone, vessels themselves to encourage better and more circulation, using stem cells therapy, using electrical stimulation, dislocating the hip joint, curating or debriding the necrotic or the dead piece of bone. Osteotomy is changing the rotation of femoral head and fixing it with an implant. And lastly, arthroplasty or joint replacement. Let's look at one by one what we as orthopedic surgeons do while treating it. Let's look at core decompression and bone grafting, which has stood the test of time. Many, many years we have been doing it. And I'll show you some examples of years together of follow-up of these patients being treated of osteonecrosis by this method. So that's the X-ray which you see on the right bottom. And that's the MRI which shows that a vascular necrosis is there of both the hip joints. And that's the core decompression which is done on one side. And what you see this double line is actually fibula strut which has been put inside. So that's immediate post-operative. That's 3 months after the operation. Another example of muscle pedicle bone grafting by using tensor fascia lata as a graft. Tensor fascia lata is the muscle which is on the side of the hip joint. So that's an example. This is how even early collapse, see the roundness of the femoral head on one side, crescent sign has appeared. So this is stage three. Some collapse is there. If you do a tensor fascia lata bone grafting, you can revert this procedure. So that's how we go laterally with the patient going there, open the muscle, open the hip joint. We do the osteotomy of the iliac crest and we take the piece of bone and push it in the femoral head. That's how it is retrieved. Tensor fascia lata graft with the piece of iliac bone. That's the pictorial description of what we do. We create a window in the hip joint, in the femoral head, curate the osteonecrotic lesion and push the graft there under image intensifier control. That's how it is pushed underneath. And that's how it looks after it has been pushed. So that's how it is lying there. That's immediate post-operative X-ray after the graft has been put there. Look at the graft which is supplying the necrotic fragment from the muscle, through the muscle, through the bone. That's immediately after 15 days and patient goes back to work very soon. Steroid-induced osteonecrosis. Been known, it's been known as I suggested, it's not only post-COVID has caused it. It's not that steroid is to be blamed because in COVID period, we used steroids, doctors used steroids all over the world to save lives of individuals because that was need of the time there. So we as doctors, we always weigh risk to benefit ratio at that point in time for that particular patient, knowing fully well that some of these patients may land up with complication of that particular medicine, which was required in the patient that time. So steroid induced bilateral osteonecrosis seen in this patient and bilateral procedure done on one side. Stage three, we have done tensor fascia lata graft. Look at this side. Tensor fascia lata graft. Stage one was there on the other side. So we wanted to do less invasive procedure. So we did core decompression. It's a very tiny procedure. We create a tunnel. We push in the bone of fibula, which is a rudimentary accessory bone in the human body. So on one side, tensor fascia lata graft on stage three. stage 1 or 2, I prefer to put core decompression bone grafting. That's 1.5 years later. Look, there is no further collapse. Patient is maintaining the good range of motion. So we are trying to preserve the head till it collapses badly, till the patient cries for pain and demands total hip replacement for getting relieved his pain. What have we achieved? We have achieved that the contour is maintained. We have achieved that patient's own hip joint is maintained. Though it looks not regular, patient's range of hip movements is good, and it is a good idea to preserve patient's head as against doing hip joint replacement early, because hip joints, artificial hip joints, also have a track record of 15, 20, 25 years. Younger the patient, they are going to become loose early. They are going to wear out early. So it is better to do a more biological operation in earlier stages of osteonecrosis than to consider hip replacement. So that's 9 years down the line. So at least we have bought 9 years of patient's own hip bone in this patient. And that's the great range of motion and walking ability of the patient on both the hip joints. What we do is, in advanced stage 3, longer incision, go on the femoral head, take the tensor fasciae latigraph, expose the necrotic portion of the femoral head, curate it, and push the tensor fasciae lata muscle graft under vision of image intensifier. So we are actually watching under X-ray control where we are pushing it, and that's how it helps the patient. So again, on one side, lesser side, we supported mechanically by this fibular strut graft after core decompression. On the more advanced side, we have done a more biological operation of muscle pedicle grafting. And that's how a patient will have a good range of motion clinically. Another example, after steroid bilateral osteonecrosis, again bilateral muscle pedicle bone grafting. That's 17 months later, 1.5 years later, 17 months later, clinical photograph. And we have published this, as I suggested. This was in Bone Grafting Journal. Let's look at still more biological operation, which is actually transferring the vessels, which is called as vascular pedicle bone grafting from iliac crest. And actually, and I won Indian Orthopedic Association's Silver Jubilee Oration on this work of mine. So that's an example. This was the hip which was hurting the patient, steroid induced. We did angiography to confirm the vascularity around the hip joint. What we do is, this is the vessel in question, which is to be transferred to the area of interest, which is the osteonecrotic zone, through the window in the neck region. So femoral head is affected. We create a window in the neck region and transfer it. So X-rays wise and MRIs wise, MRI was positive. X-ray showed on the left side involvement, so stage 1. Right side was stage 0 because MRI was positive, but X-ray was negative. This gentleman is actually a scientist. So that's how we picked up the circulation, the vessels in this area. Postoperatively, we checked it up. On one side, we did core decompression and fibula grafting there. On the other side, we did vascularized pedicle grafting on the left side. And see how beautifully now it is trying to revascularize completely. That's 3 years down the line. And even the fibula gets completely amalgamated without allowing further collapse of the roundness of the femoral head. That is 7 years down the line. Free fibula on the same patient, free fibula on one side, vascularized iliac crest on the other side, that's 7 years down the line. That's the range of motion. That's 10 years down the line. Fibula is completely resorbed. Vascular iliac crest is completely resorbed. There is no deterioration. There is no further collapse. And the patient has progressed well. That's 14 years down the line, same patient. That's 14 years down the line. And that's 20 years follow-up of this patient. Now, slowly the collapse has started occurring, but still we have bought 20 years for this patient with his own hip joint preserved. Patient has still not undergone any hip replacement. So that's how it has been preserved. Let's look at osteotomy. So one sector is involved, we can rotate it, and the sector of a rounded femoral head, which is non-adult, is brought into weight-bearing zone. That's osteotomy. But my problem with osteotomy is because we change the architecture of proximal femur of the hip joint, further conversion to total hip replacement becomes difficult. It's not impossible, and we have done many, but the success rate goes down for sure. Outcome prediction becomes difficult. So it is better to do other surgeries like of hip preservation than to consider doing an osteotomy. It's technically difficult. Results continue to be unpredictable. Total hip replacement becomes difficult. Total hip replacements is a gold standard for stage 4 for advanced osteoarthritis. Who decides total hip replacement to be done? Patient, individual decides based on his or her pain. Surgeon decides based on his or her X-ray findings. If there is a huge collapse, if the stage has progressed to stage 4, complete collapse with secondary arthritic changes, then and then only last resort has to be a total hip replacement. Why? Because failure of total hip replacement is known in some patients with ongoing local disease. Steroids, lot of focal osteoporosis, bad bone quality is there. There are patients who rheumatoid arthritis, for example, Sandhivat, will continue to take steroids. These are younger patients, so their level of activity is very high. Their demand on their hips is very high. So the chances of hips getting loose, getting worn out is very high. And they have, some of them have increased body weight. So the recent trends is, of course, try to preserve the hip. There are some papers, scientific work, which we have done, which I have looked at implantation of bone marrow cells, stem cells, using stem cell therapy in some patients, harvesting patients' own stem cells and putting them at the osteonecrotic zone is also being considered in early stages. Some treatment which I have no experience about is biophysical stimulation of this hip joint, trying to reverse the process in very, very early stages is also been described and been known. So, message, my friends, is early detection is the basis of treating successfully osteonecrosis. Clinical examination, clinical acumen, good history by the individuals to the doctor, reporting of the individuals to a sensible good physician is important, and that good physician colleague of mine to diagnose it early is important, and for that clinical examination and MRI for that good patient is probably the best investigation to diagnose. Core decompression with bone grafting is preferred in early stages till stage 3. Only core decompression is useless. Multiple hole drilling is useless. It has to be adequate drilling of femoral head to decompress it, and of course supplement that mechanically done good track with either fibula or good punching of bone grafts. Cancellous bone grafting procedure, other muscle pedicle procedure, the best is of course tensor fasciae lata bone grafting using the muscle pedicle. But in this entire group of doing muscle pedicle bone grafting, vascularized iliac crest bone grafting seems to be more predictable, more rewarding to the patient, with almost a predictable result amounting to 95% success rate. So if you choose the patient right in early stages, this seems to be the way to go. Osteotomies show successful results only when performed for a localized lesion. Of course, we as orthopedic surgeons must know and understand that however good we do osteotomy or any procedure, we are touching a good field and converting that into a already performed surgery field for a future hip replacement. So please undertake a procedure which will not create hindrance for future predictable result of arthroplasty or hip replacement. Thus, for all pre-collapse hips, also some select collapse of early post-collapse, vascularized iliac crest bone grafting seems to be a procedure of choice today, followed by tensor fasciae lata bone grafting. My message at the end of our 45 years of work, which I have inherited from my father, orthopedic surgeon, Dr. Sudhir Babulkar, and I have taken further his work in terms of doing more and more head preservation surgery, is if there is no collapse, no crescent sign, consider core decompression bone grafting. If crescent sign has started appearing, but early collapse, consider vascularized pedicle bone grafting or muscle pedicle bone grafting. If some sectoral collapse, may be considered a rotation osteotomy, or I still prefer vascularized iliac crest bone grafting even in that stage. But of course, if arthritic changes have appeared, secondary arthritis, collapse, difficult range of motion, young patient, painful hip, THR, total hip replacement is way to go. I hope I have cleared doubts in minds of all physicians listening to us on this topic. Coming back to post-COVID, post-steroid, all the patients that we are lately seeing in our clinical practice in last month, 6 weeks, who is to be blamed? We do not know whether it is post-COVID, whether it is post-steroid, but certainly there is increase tremendously in the numbers of what we used to see in pre-COVID times. We have a significant number of patients now gathered who have been admitted for COVID in COVID-dedicated hospitals, who have received long-term steroids for saving their lives. But now, unfortunately, some of them are reporting with hip pain, some of them with low back pain or knee pain. And on early diagnosis, they are being found to have osteonecrosis of the hip. My request to patient individuals, my request to fellow colleague physicians and orthopedic surgeons, is to keep this entity in mind when you come across a patient of hip pain. Make sure that you clinically examine, do the sectoral division test, do X-ray and MRI and diagnose them early. If you diagnose them early, maybe we can reverse the complete process and save the patients of their ailment, these young patients of their disability, which will otherwise for sure happen. Thank you very much. I will stop sharing. If there are any questions, I am happy to answer.
Sir, the questions have been put in the chat box.
Yeah, I'm looking at them. Post-pregnancy, what are the commonly cure? Okay, post-pregnancy also, or during pregnancy also, we see osteonecrosis, and that's related to pregnancy, and it's a known entity, and we want to save the femoral head. I will refrain myself from Delta Plus treatment. I will only confine myself to the topic of osteonecrosis. So what is the Delta Plus treatment? I will skip that. How can I manage post-COVID nutrition? I will skip that. Fatigue, facial jaw pain, spreading to teeth. I will skip that because I would want to specifically answer patients who have hip pain, osteonecrosis, and I have descriptively already talked about how we can tackle the hip pain problems. What is the incidence of AVN in COVID patients? So for example, in last 6 to 8 weeks since we have opened up our orthopedic, dedicated orthopedic practice, because my hospital was a dedicated COVID center in Nagpur. And since we have started back, I see almost 5 to 6 hip pain patients every day, as against 1 or 2 patients of osteonecrosis every day, which I used to see. Please remember, our center is already an established referral center for osteonecrosis or avascular necrosis. So this number is significantly high. And we have in record more than 35 patients post-COVID, post-steroid-induced suspected avascular necrosis, osteonecrosis. And 2 of them have already undergone total hip replacement. So that's a very big number. I cannot for sure tell you, nobody knows about that, that how much percentage of patients post-COVID will end up in osteonecrosis. No one knows that. Also, please highlight on hip pain problems in such patients. So patients complain of acute excruciating hip pain. Young patients become suddenly wheelchair bound to that extent. Once you clinically examine, the flexion tends to be restricted. The knee points to the ipsilateral, same side shoulder, that's called as sectoral deviation. Normally, it should go on the opposite side. So that suggests that the anterosuperolateral portion of the hip joint or the femoral head is getting sensitive. It's getting osteonecrotic. That's the sector which is the first affected. And that sign is the first sign to get elicited, sometimes even before the X-ray shows, because that becomes a more sensitive zone. This hip pain can also radiate itself to low back pain. I have, again, in my armamentarium, almost 6 patients who have been treated for last 3-4 months for hip pain, for low back pain as an acute PID patient. Patient has undergone MRI of lumbar spine, unfortunately not of the hip, otherwise we would have diagnosed them early. And now, once they have come to me and I have done their MRI and X-ray, there is already collapse of the hip. Patient has already progressed to stage 3 and stage 4. So again, it is important to diagnose the patients early in stage 1 and 2 if they can be done. Can the stress in runners produce avascular necrosis? No, stress in runners cannot produce avascular necrosis. Our hip joint is extremely strong. Only vascular insult of some kind can produce a vascular necrosis. Stress risers, osteomalacia, or rickets can give rise to stress risers around hip joint, around pelvis bone, but that's not a vascular necrosis. That's fatigue fractures, which are seen secondary to osteomalacia. I think if there are no more questions, we are good to go.
So there is one more question which I put.
A vascular necrosis in case of sickle cell patient, please suggest something. In sickle cell disease, which is a genetically inherent disease, which is seen in a significant population in central India, and there is a belt which goes right from Madhya Pradesh to Nagpur to Bastar region. And because of sickle cell crisis, wherein red cells become sickle and they entangle and they cause microembolization and they block the arterioles. So it is seen in the hip joint, it is seen in the shoulder joint. Of course, sickle cell disease can be treated with avoiding the oxygen crisis by giving soda bicarb, zinc, folic acid, supportive treatment. But if the femoral head gets affected, we can do core decompression bone grafting, a very successful surgery. Vascular pedicle bone grafting doesn't work very well in sickle cell patients. Core decompression works very well in stage 1, 2, and 3. We should try to avoid doing a hip replacement, because most of these patients, despite of irregular, very deformed hip joint, tends to be clinically accepting the pain, the range of motion which is limited. Their pain is not too bad. They accept this amount of deformity. So though the X-ray is very, very grotesque to look at, clinically, patient is not too bad. It is always for a good physician to decide a surgery. We always look at the patient. We always look at the clinical demand of the patient, what patient wants. And X-ray or MRI is always to support a good physician whether that surgery is required, should be offered to the patient or not. Of course, if the hip becomes extremely painful, it is causing even limitation in the walk or limitation in activities of daily living, an uncemented total hip replacement is the way to go for sickle cell destroyed arthritic hip. It's true about the next question was, what about arthritis patients suffering from AVN? So if one reaches stage 4 arthritis, and if that arthritis is causing limitation of movements, limitation of activities of daily living and huge amount of pain, then only consider hip replacement. If the pain is not too much, if the collapse is not too bad, till the last resort, we as an orthopedic surgeons, we as physicians must advocate the use of head preserving surgeries of some kind till hip replacement is really, really warranted. Okay. I think that brings us to the end of this session.
Yes, sir. No more questions.
All right, thank you very much, Minal, to be around. I thank you very much,
Zuventus,
for this excellent backup, scientific backup for this seminar. And I wish to thank Science Integra to put this all together. Thanks, Subbu. Thanks, Minal. And I hope this will give some direction for the patients, for the individuals, for the physicians, for orthopedic surgeons who are listening to us. Thank you very much. Take care and goodbye.
Thank you very much. Thanks. Thank you.